Our next guest is a business journalist who has covered and extensively written about the late Bobby Ongpin. Lala Rimando joins us live to share her own recollection of the technocrat. Lala, hi, good morning.
Hi, Mimi.
All right, Lala, you were supposed to have a meeting with Mr. Bobby Ongpin this February 9th. That meeting will no longer be happening. Are you shocked? Did this come as a surprise to you? Or was he, I mean, what are your thoughts? How are you feeling right now?
I was like thinking to myself, it's just a few days until our next interview. And I was really shocked. He seemed very bossy as usual. He's his usual. I have to do it my way. Actually, during our email exchanges for the interview on Thursday, I asked him that if he can, once we pin down the schedule for our interview, I'll send him a Zoom. His reply was, no, I'll send you the Zoom link. I'll do it my way, something like that. He's his usual.
As usual. Of course, this Zoom meeting was supposed to be for a collaboration for a book you're writing on Mr. Go Hongwei, correct?
Yes, it's actually a biography project on Mr. John Go Hongwei. It's apparently his good friend way back in the 70s when Mr. Ongpin was still trade secretary. He and Mr. John apparently had some good vibes going on. They would talk about derivatives. They would talk about big things, big picture things. You know how these tycoons tend to gravitate toward others who also share the same wavelengths as they are. So that's the dynamic between him and Mr. John Go Hongwei. And since my current project is on the biography of Mr. John Go Hongwei, I really was looking forward to meeting him again.
Of course, I read your post on Facebook and you said the first time you met him face to face was at a Senate hearing where you had to write an investigative series that he did not like. That was the start of the relationship. Eventually, you two grew on each other, I guess. You two just developed some liking for each other. How is it working?
Respect.
How is it working with him from a journalist's perspective? Was he hard? You say he was bossy, usual bossy, but was he hard? Was he straightforward all the time? Did he have a soft spot? What do you think do people don't know or don't understand about him?
Well, when I first met him, it was on a story that I did on his transactions about Philex Mining. He bought the shares of Mr. John Go Hongwei and Mr. Manny Zamora in Philex and then used the money of DBP to acquire those shares. Then after several batches, turned around and sold those shares to Manny Pangilinan, who was then looking to acquire a majority control on Philex. So it was just a straightforward three-part series, which I did for abscbnnews.com that time. And basically, I interviewed the DBP president, Ray David, at that time. I have quotes from the regulators, Banco Central regulators at that time. It was a full-fledged research, and it was a very solid story. He just didn't like it because it called attention. Well, in the first place, he's the type of the tycoon who wants to do it his way, his timing, in a narrative that he himself shaped. You know, very, very straightforward, as I said. At the same time, not as progressive as other tycoons now. If you notice, a lot of tycoons now would deal with journalists as if, you know, they're trying to see it from the journalist's point of view, at the same time build a relationship with that journalist and hoping that the journalist will come up with a rosy report on him, or at least a fair report. In the case of Mr. Ongpin, he likes to bombard you with his points of view, his way or highway, something like that. So he didn't like my report because it did not, he didn't call it, basically. And that report triggered a series of Senate interviews in 2011. That's why you see footages of him being in a Senate panel in 2011. He didn't like it. He didn't show up for a few hearings. But I positioned myself in the Senate hearing so that I wanted to make sure that I would meet him because he was based in the in Europe most of the time at that time. So when he saw me, he's like, oh, so that's you. I want to have lunch with you or something like that. He said something not safe for work type of comment. And then we did have lunch at the Alpha Land building. And it was a long lunch where I just basically, he just did a power play on me. And I just went ahead and listened to him narrating how important he is all the way to him having this experience of his blood extracted in Europe and the medical people there finding out that his blood, his cells levels are of a certain royalty line, something like that. Essentially, it was a lunch where he was saying how important he is. And then I just accepted it and then went on to us being friends afterward. I think we established a mutual respect where he allows me to have my own independent reporting, and then I allow him to just, you know, highlight how important he is. And he is. I did profile him. I did try to understand his dealings, how his importance in Philippine business. He has his footprints in Tagaytay Highlands, in Meralco, Petron. We just know him to be involved in Balesin and his previous run with Duterte on PhilWeb, etc. But he's involved. He's the one who got the Robert Kuok of Shangri-La to come over and invest in the Philippines. That's why we have Shangri-La hotels right now. Mm-hmm. His mind is never resting.
It's always,
after he came back from exile, because he was trade secretary of Marcos for 7 years, he has a, you know, these brilliant minds who just wouldn't stop thinking of innovations, of several ways of doing things. He's that kind of guy, very visionary.
Visionary. Lala, final question. What do you say to people? There are some who remark or comment that the legends are passing one by one, that we don't, you know, we don't make them quite the same way. The tycoons from that era their mold is so different from the new breed that we have today. What do you think? What are your thoughts on that?
Very true. But then these are the tycoons who grew up post-war or during the war. Mm-hmm. They were shaped differently. Their, I don't know, their DNA, their principles, their ethics were shaped differently at that time. That's why it's hard for them to it's very few tycoons were able to themselves adjust to new way of doing things now. It's good that they have new generations of kids or of grandkids were able to appreciate and accept that there's such a thing as sustainability, that the board has to have, you know, women directors, etc. I don't know. To me, it's just passing on toward a new era. Does it make it better or worse? It's just different, just like how it is in life, right?
Mm-hmm. And Lala, of course, you are a journalist. You write all of these things. If we could ask you, you knew him so well, his business dealings, you covered him extensively. How would you write a piece on his life and legacy? What would the title be of that piece if you were to write one?
I'm actually writing one right now. And my tentative title is, They Don't Make Him Like This Anymore, something like that. Wow. I'm still working on it. But yeah, it's one in... He's different. He's unique in that sense.
All
very
right.
Brilliant. Very forceful.
Brilliant and forceful. Lala, thank you so much for joining us this morning and for sharing your experience and what you know about this man that we always read about and talk about in the news, but very few really experience the brilliance of. Thank you again for joining us. Have a good day.
Thank you as well.